Hi everybody, it's Dr. A. Our next video in molecular techniques is going to be over amplification techniques. Okay, so amplification is often the first step in any molecular technique after the extraction of the nucleic acids. The target amplification is an in vitro method for enzymatic replication of a target molecule to levels at which it can be detected. It allows a target sequence to be identified and then further characterized or tested. The types of amplification are polymerase chain reaction, or PCR, that is the most widely used, and it was in the news, has been in the news with COVID, of course, COVID PCR. Then you have transcription-mediated amplification, or TMA, strand displacement amplification, SDA, and nucleic acid sequence-based amplifications. So let's look at polymerase chain reaction. So it is the most widely used amplification technique. It uses a thermal cycler to produce millions of DNA copies to increase analytical sensitivity. So you have more product to test, and so you can get better reactions. And it's a thermal cycler because it cycles through temperatures, raising and lowering the temperature. And the more cycles it runs through, the more copies of the DNA are generated. So the steps of a cycle include the denaturation step. So that is heating the sample to 94 to 98 degrees Celsius, which separates the DNA strand. So the two DNA strands will become single-stranded. And then you have annealing. So when you cool it to 50 to 65 degrees Celsius with some primers, the primers will bind to the single-stranded DNA. And then once the primers are bound, then the polymerase enzyme can produce new strands. That happens at 72 degrees Celsius, and it does that by adding the nucleotides to the primers and growing the chain. So it copies, you know, each of the single-stranded DNA chains, their code into a chain. And then there's a final hold after the adequate amount of cycles have occurred to preserve the DNA that's produced. And the hold is going to be at 4 to 15 degrees Celsius, so a cool hold. And the amount of DNA will double with each cycle. So you will go denaturation, annealing, extension, and then denaturation, annealing, extension. Until you've done the programmed amount of cycles. So that could be, you know, 30 cycles can generate like millions of copies of DNA. And then when it finally finishes that 30th cycle, then it does a final hold. So this is PCR illustrated. So you have your double-stranded DNA. It is denatured and you have each of the strand get separated. Primers anneal. Then there's replication. And then you repeat it, and then so these will separate, etc. And so from one you get two you get four, etc. It keeps doubling. So when the target is a microbial RNA or messenger RNA, the RNA must be enzymatically converted to DNA by the reverse transcriptase enzyme as a first step. And real-time PCR, which is a technique of collecting data through the PCR process as it occurs, there's a combination of amplification and detection in one step. So when we've been talking about PCR COVID testing, a lot of them has been real-time PCR COVID testing. So the detection step will use fluorescent molecules that can correlate the PCR product concentration to the fluorescence intensity. The DNA melt curve analysis is an assessment of the dissociation characteristics of double-stranded DNA during heating. As the temperature is raised, the double-stranded DNA begins to disassociate, which leads to a rise in the absorbance intensity. The temperature at which 50% of the DNA is denatured is known as the melting temperature. This varies from sample to sample due to the A, T, and CG content of the sample. So if you have a high CG content, it leads to a higher melting temperature. PCR is limited by expense, by the need for the special thermocyclers, potential aerosol contamination, nonspecific annealing, and degree of stringency. So to explain stringency, if the conditions of stringency are high, the probe won't bind to the target. If the conditions of stringency are low, then the probe binds to unrelated targets. So that's a way to describe what's going on in the reaction. So next, we have transcription-mediated amplification. So it detects target RNA, and it involves a continuous isothermic, so means at one temperature, no temperature change. Then there are cycles of reverse transcription. So because we're using RNA, right? So we have to use reverse transcription. It is a single tube nucleic acid amplification system. It uses two enzymes, RNA polymerase and reverse transcriptase. So it involves the DNA synthesis via reverse transcriptase and then RNA transcription via RNA polymerase to produce an RNA amplicon. So we are amplifying RNA. So that is a source or product of amplification from the target nucleic acid, so the target RNA that we're trying to amplify. The first system amplified RNA target in two steps. There was first a generation of complementary DNA from the target RNA, and then the reverse transcription of the complementary DNA template into multiple copies of RNA. And then that is then uses RNA transcription, to continue using RNA polymerase. You'll see here, I'll explain it here in just a second with the graphic that I made. There are two other non-PCR methods that were developed from this one. I'm not going to go specifically into those though, but there are nucleic acid sequence-based amplification and transcription-mediated amplification, which is the one I'm going to explain. So we're going to go all the steps. So the first steps I talked about the first techniques, but we're going to go all the way through so you can see what's going on. So first we start with our RNA and we incubate it with a primer, and then reverse transcriptase is in there, and it will bind to the primer and it's going to add nucleotides to it and make complementary DNA. And then reverse transcriptase has an RNAase activity, meaning it degrades RNA. So reverse transcriptase is then going to degrade the RNA strand and make a complementary strand of DNA to match. So now it's made double-stranded DNA. And now we have a double-stranded DNA template that was made from the RNA sequence. Okay. Now we take this double-stranded DNA sample and we incubate it with RNA polymerase. And it's going to read the double-stranded DNA and make a bunch of RNA amplicons. So it'll keep copying this DNA code into RNA. And then one of these or all of these can go back through the process. So this is all happening at the same time. So it can bind with the RNA primer, reverse transcriptase makes complementary DNA, the RNA gets degraded, the second strand gets made, you have a double-stranded DNA template, and now RNA polymerase can use it to make a bunch of RNA amplicons. And so that is TMA. Then we have strand displacement amplification, or SDA. So it's also isothermal, so happening at one temperature. It's an in vitro method of amplifying a target DNA or RNA sequence. There are two steps. There's the target generation first, and then the exponential target amplification, which is isothermal. One set of primers incorporates a specific restriction enzyme that is later attacked by an endonuclease, which creates a nick, so it's a cut in one strand. Only one strand of the DNA is labeled with that restriction enzyme. The resulting nick that is created in the one strand by the restriction enzyme then allows for the displacement of the amplified strands. So the nick strand is removed from the double-stranded DNA, which allows another strand to be formed. And then the amplified strands in turn can serve as target for further amplification and nick digestion. So let me show you my illustration here. So we're gonna start with double-stranded DNA, which is going to be denatured. And then there are two primers that are going to anneal this time. There is a bump primer here and an amplification primer with that restriction enzyme loaded on it. And with DNA polymerase is going to attach to the primers and start adding nucleotides. And so this one's going to go first. So it's running and reading and adding nucleotides, but then the bump primer is coming behind it, bumping it off the DNA strand here. And so that it literally is pushing it, pulling it off like Velcro or something here. It's, you know, pushing that strand off. And so then you have amplification number one, which is the one half of the DNA strand in the copy of the DNA strand that was started by the bump primer. But then you also have here the one that got bumped off, which has the amplification primer that has a restriction enzyme. And then it can be copied on extension number two by DNA polymerase and become again double stranded. So it says, oh, this one's single stranded, let's make it double stranded, so it adds the nucleotides that are complementary to it all the way through. So then we have this target double stranded DNA that's been modified. It has this restriction enzyme on it. So the endonuclease sees it. It sees this restriction enzyme target here, and it just will attack it. And so it'll eat it and digest it, which makes a nick. It makes a cut in that primer. And so DNA polymerase says, wait a second, this is not good. So it's going to bind here and it's going to start adding nucleotides to this part of the nick, bumping basically this one back off again, just causing a displacement of this strand. So it goes and adds, displaces this top strand, which then you have, this becomes a double-stranded DNA. And then this one will get its second, its complementary strand will be added to it. And then so now you've got two sets of double-stranded DNA from the one you started with. Plus, you have this amplification product also. And so, and then it goes back through the cycle again, and it can keep producing these strands. So that is strand displacement amplification, or SDA. And then you have some probe amplifications. So there are several techniques that can amplify the detection molecules or the probe itself instead of the target. So ligase chain reaction is one of them. It uses two pairs of label probes that are complementary for two short target DNA sequences that are in close proximity. After the hybridization of the probes to the strands, the DNA ligase will interpret the break between the ends of the probes as a nick and link the probe pairs. This is followed then by standard PCR amplification. This has helped increase specificity of the reactions, and it can be used for the detection of single base mutations. So in a double-stranded DNA sample, in here noted in black is the target area that we're trying to detect. And it's incubated with four probes that are complementary to each half of the strand on each half of the code on each strand. Okay, so DNA is denatured at 94, the long strands separate, and then the probes will be able to anneal at 55 degrees Celsius with some cooling. So the probes anneal, and then ligase sees the nick as a need to be repaired, so it joins the probes. And so now if you denature it, again, so now you have two long strands with a target area, and then you have the two short strands that are made from the probes, and then you can denature it again, which would separate the probe, the linked probes from the long strands, and then these probes can be further amplified because the sequence will be complementary, and then ligase can join them again, and then this can go back through incubation with the probes, etc., and you can keep amplifying the probes. So each cycle doubles the amount of target DNA. And then signal amplification is designed to increase the signal strength by increasing the concentration of a label. It employs multiple probes and several simultaneous hybridization steps. It is best known as the branch chain signal amplification. It is the most recent system. It has high specificity and can provide a quantitative detection over a broad range. It is well suited for the detection of nucleic acid targets that have a sequence heterogeneity, and so hepatitis C and HIV are two of them. So that means that they are differences in the sequences between different viruses, even though they're all, you know, they're either all hepatitis C or all HIV, there are some variations in the code. And so that allows the detection of, genetic material that has some heterogeneity or some variation, if you will. So in this one, we have a capture well, a plate in which you have capture probes that are affixed. The capture extender will bind onto capture probe and will be able to bind the target RNA here. So for hepatitis C or for HIV, and then the preamplifier can bind to the target RNA if it is there and bound on the extender probes, the capture probes. And then the preamplifier will be able to bind the amplifier and the label probe. And so that makes double-stranded DNA that is labeled and it's branched. So it forms these branches off the preamplifier, and that's why it's branched DNA amplification. And so you have a lot of signal probe here going on, and that's light fluorescence that's emitted from the signal probe is what is detected. So that's bDNA testing there for you. All right, that wraps up this video on molecular. More to come. Stay tuned.